Mic check. Am I on?
Came out not. I'm sick, and my voice is going out. And I thought, you know, I'm going to go out there, but I'm not going to sing. It didn't happen. 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood. Grace and peace be yours in abundance. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Kicking off a new series in 1 Peter tonight. We are in the salutation. We are in the greeting. And if this was a stream that you would reach your hands deep in and pull them up, you would pull out gold every time. Gold is a rich, rich, rich text that I'm excited to present to you this evening. Let me pray for us. Well, Father, we stand before this text knowing that you have a plan for our lives, that we are here under your providential will, that on this Tuesday we would gather in this room like this, knowing that you have plans for us. And I pray that your Holy Spirit would awaken us to the truth that you have for us here in Dallas, in Fort Worth, in Houston, in Oklahoma, El Paso, and all over the world. Would you awaken hearts, create a revival, a great awakening? Amen. What do you think about when you hear the word chosen? What comes to mind? What does that, you know, bring about in your hearts and your mind as you hear the word that someone is chosen? What it does for me is it stirs all the insecurities of sixth grade, fifth grade, fourth grade, where you're split into team captains and everybody lines up, whether you're playing kickball or baseball or flag football or Red Rover, whatever the game is, right? That there's team captains like, hey, I'll take you, then I'll take you. And some of you love this. Like, this is what you were made for, because you know you were going first round, second round draft pick. Like, you knew that you're an athlete. You're the best there is. You're out there. You're discouraged that you're not one of the captains, but you know the captain's your boy and he's about to choose you first or second, right? You know that's going to happen, right? And then others of you, you're still in counseling because of this moment. This brings back all the insecurities. You're up there and you know that everybody, one by one, slowly, like as time is standing still, is going to be chosen and divided amongst these two people until you are left standing there all alone, you and the trash can. And they have to choose between you and the trash can. And in a moment of weakness, they say, give me the human that is firmly the camp that I'm in. That was the experience that I lived over and over and over again. Unless they didn't know me. Because like sometimes I'd go to like the basketball court and I could look like I could play ball. Like I'm 2 feet taller than everybody else and I have my Nike socks pulled up high and my Nike shorts, my Air Raids. And I was standing there and if they didn't know me, they're like, yo, give me the tall guy. Joke's on you, buddy. I'm bad. You know? Chosen. It can stir up that insecurity. And then it just kind of continues in life, right? Whether we're chosen for dates or chosen for a college or chosen for a job or an internship or chosen for marriage. And there's times that time and time again where we feel like we're not chosen. And in this rich text, I want to hit you with a theological truth that if you are here and you're going to be in heaven forever, that you have been chosen by God. And that if we can embrace this theological truth that we have been chosen by the creator of the heavens and the earth, all of those things I just listed fade into the background. They are not important. And you think, how can that be? Not getting married is not important. How can that possibly be? Not getting a job? I mean, those are natural. How could that not be important? But if we can grasp this evening the reality that you've been chosen by God, that would fade into the backdrop. Here in 1 Peter, I've had conversations with some of you that really struggle with this idea that God would choose some and not others. And I think if we dig back, it comes down to a place where you say, well, that's not fair. It's not fair that God would do that. He'd choose some and it's not fair. And I'm here to tell you, it's not fair. God's not fair. If God was fair, he'd choose no one. It's so much better than fair that God would invite you into the riches of his abundance, grace, eternal riches forever and ever and ever, an inheritance that you could never, ever deserve, and yet he extends it to you freely. It's not fair. And so we need this book that Peter wrote. And why did he write it? About 64 AD, the church is facing extreme persecution. It is on the rise. The emperor is Nero. And Nero is like that crazy fraternity brother that you had or that you knew of. He's that guy that always takes things a little too far, always gets a little too drunk. And he's like, let's get in a fight. You know, let's go streaking. Let's burn down Rome. That's Nero, okay? He's a crazy madman. He is a lunatic. You're like, he's either going to be in a circus or in prison or run for president. And we all hope it's not the third one, but it might be all three somehow. Like, that's Nero, okay? And so just to tell you, he killed his mom because she objected to his sexual affairs. After his wife died, he married his male servant, had him castrated because his servant resembled his wife. He set Rome on fire, and historians say that he walked through the palace and played the fiddle as it burned to the ground. And then he brought Christians forward and tortured them until they confessed to burning down Rome so that people would hate them, because he took all of his angst and he targeted this group called the Way, this group called Christians, that he would later take them, dip them in wax, and light them on fire on the side of the road to give light. He's a lunatic. And when you cannot trust the leader that is over you and you feel oppressed by that leader, you need hope. And so Peter, at just the right moment in history, penned this letter from Rome to give the scattered church hope. And so this evening, as we move through it, we're looking at how you have been chosen to be obedient, how you have been chosen to be made, to be born again, and how you've been chosen to receive an inheritance. Peter, an apostle of Christ Jesus to the elect. This doctrine of elect, it's not hidden in this text. It's right there off the bat. He's showing you the doctrine of election right off the bat. He's not afraid of it. It's very matter-of-factly. To the exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. I can show you on a map. This is modern-day Turkey, almost exactly modern-day Turkey. And the church is scattered through this so that we would read it thousands of years later and be encouraged. Who have been chosen, underline that word chosen, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. This word foreknowledge here, it's the word prognosis. In the Greek, it's the word prognosis. It's where we get the exact word in the English, prognosis, the results of something. Prognosis, it's the result. Right? And so God's foreknowledge is not that, and this is important, it's not that he looks ahead and sees the future. It's that he made the future, that he knows the future intimately. It's like this. I know that tomorrow's Wednesday. God has ordained every event of Wednesday. in his foreknowledge. He knows Wednesday, every second of Wednesday. Through the sanctifying work of the Spirit to be obedient, underline that, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood. So this very first sentence alludes to the doctrine of election, the doctrine of predestination, the doctrine of sanctification, the doctrine of the foreknowledge of God and the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit working together to choose you. Do you see what I mean by such a rich text? Grace and peace be yours in abundance. My first point this evening is that you've been chosen to be made obedient. That you have been chosen to be made obedient. Who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work. Chosen for what? Chosen to be obedient to Jesus Christ. That you have a new Lord, Jesus. That you do not go through life doing whatever you want to do. This is, my friends, this is the single most distinguishing characteristic of the Christian. That you no longer do what you want to do. And there are things that you don't want to do that you do. That you no longer do what you naturally want to do. And you do things that you don't naturally want to do. We hold our money loosely. We give it away. We care for the poor. We don't just follow our sexual urges. This is the mark of the follower of Christ, the one who has been chosen. And we do these things willingly and voluntarily with the help of the Spirit, by the Spirit's work. God has changed us and given us a new master. This concept right here, friends, this is what God used to save me. And I've told you the story before, but I want to teach through it for just a moment. So let me tell you the story, and then I'll teach through it. I stumbled into this place hungover, sat in the back row, wearing the clothes from the night before, from the club, and I began to wrestle with this idea. Who is God? Always said that I believed in God, never made a decision that was impacted by my belief in God. So it was like, I believe in God, but I'm going to get drunk, and I'm going to have sex, and I'm going to have fun, and I'm going to party, and I'm going to do whatever I want to do. But I believe in God. It was a statement of belief, not an act of belief. Behavior always follows our belief, right? And so there I am, and I'm in the back row, and the guy tells this goofy story, dumb story, God used it to save my life, about a horse, a wild stallion. The horse just wanted to be free, roam the mountaintops in its pursuit of freedom until, people would try to capture it, but it just wanted to be free. Till one day, a farmer, villager, local cowboy successfully captured the horse, put a rope around his neck, and took him home. And loved him, cared for him, provided for him, and eventually broke him and was able to ride him. And when he would ride this horse, he would lead him to food, he would lead him to water, and he would provide shelter for him. And the line that God used to save me was, the horse wasn't completely free until he was fully submissive to his master. Now, I came in, my life looked like I had it together. You know, I worked in a high-rise building, wore a suit every day, had the Jaguar S-Type that I'd take to work, and lived in the condo in Uptown. But I wanted to be free. All of those things were the pursuit of freedom for me. Now, let me retell that story. I want you to look at verse 2 closely. When the rope was placed around that horse's neck, he was chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. When he was being broken, this is through the sanctifying work of the Spirit. And when he found true freedom, he was obedient to Jesus Christ. And you say, how can true freedom come from obedience? Because he is the only master that can truly lead you to freedom. You cannot find freedom on your own. You cannot find freedom in the world. And let me illustrate this. Let me give you a paradox. Two very different people. Let's take the homeless beggar on the corner and the billionaire in the corner office in the estate with acreage and employees, and both of them, and it's a broad stereotype statement, I realize, both of them are in their situation, according to my illustration, because of their pursuit of freedom. This man wants the freedom from authority, the freedom from rules, the freedom from anyone telling him what to do, so much so that he's found the freedom from the existence of a house and bills. And the man, and this guy believes that him
that his riches, collecting riches, piling riches, having so much that he can do whatever he wants to do is a path to freedom. That's what some of you believe here tonight. You think, hey, I'm going to try to become a millionaire before I'm 30, or maybe now before I'm 40, or a billionaire, so that I can do whatever I want. You were not made to do whatever you want. You were made to do what God wants. And God did not choose you based on your ability. He chose you based on what he can do through you. The eyes of the Lord go to and fro, looking for hearts that are fully his. What does the Lord want? A humble and contrite spirit. He did not choose you, write it down, he did not choose you based on what you can do, but based on what he can do through you. Romans 10:9, if you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, you have a new Lord, and believe in your heart that God has the power to raise him from the dead, you will be saved. And so obedience is believing that Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit are leading you, that you are protected by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, verse 2, and you are shielded by God's power until the coming age. That's coming in just a minute in verse 5. And God is helping you in your obedience. What happens when you do something wrong, believer? You're convicted. You get in your car and that quiet voice says you shouldn't have done that. It's conviction. It's not guilt for the believer. It's conviction. You shouldn't have done that. You shouldn't have went there with him. You shouldn't have went there with them. You shouldn't have drank that much. You shouldn't have looked at that. You shouldn't have gone back to that website. You shouldn't have pulled it up on your phone. You should not have done that. You shouldn't have called him back. You should not have called him. That's God helping you. And if it's not there, if you say, no, I'm going to continue to sleep with my significant other, and I don't feel bad about it, I think God's given me the freedom. Whoa, now we're in dangerous ground. I don't feel bad about it. What are you saying? The Holy Spirit isn't helping me. You may not be a believer. You may not have realized God's choosing. If it's not happening, then that is concerning. Second point from this text. You've been chosen to be born into a living hope. Verse 3, praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth, underline this, new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. A new birth means a new family. That you have a new family, that you have a new life, that this is the way the scriptures describe it, that you have a new birth into a living hope. Let me explain. I sat in Algebra 2 behind Kayla, and you guys don't know Kayla, but Kayla was the most perfect individual I had ever met at the time. She was born into a family with a lot of money. She had the cool mom. The mom that would take her to wrap houses or do whatever. You know, the cool mom, that was her mom. She was always smiling. And she was more beautiful than any human being should be. And she smelled like cotton candy. And I would sit behind her in algebra, too. And I would think, what does this girl have to do in life? I mean, she's got to get up and eat, and go back to sleep at some point. Like, that's it. Like, that's what she needs to do, and all of the world is going to give her whatever she wants for the rest of the rest. Like, she's going to be the head cheerleader and get the job and in the interview, and everybody loves her, and the most popular. I mean, she's Kayla, right? She's got everything coming her way, except she's going to die. And then what? It doesn't matter what family she was born into then, or how perfectly symmetrical her eyes were, how perfect her hair always was. God doesn't care that she smells like cotton candy. He made her that way. It's not a shoe into heaven. Unless she has been received a new birth into the living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That first birth doesn't matter. That gets you 80 years maybe on, you know, if you're lucky, right? Lucky, God's providence, I don't know. She's got to be born again. That's what Jesus said. Peter knew this because Jesus taught this in John chapter 3. It's the only two places in the New Testament it shows up. Nicodemus asked Jesus, what do you mean born again? And he says, you must be born of both water, that's a natural birth, and of the Spirit, that's salvation, that you must be born again. And Peter lived it because you remember, Peter was a fisherman. Jesus comes up to him and says, put down your nets. You're going to be a fisher of men. Follow me. And then we see Peter, and he constantly is messing everything up, constantly putting his foot in his mouth, constantly just messing things up. And then he even to the point of denying Jesus, he's such a coward, he doesn't even say that, hey, that's my best friend, because he's nervous about this 12-year-old girl and whatever's going to happen to him. And so he denies Jesus. And then Jesus shows back up on the scene and says, do you love me, Peter? Or do you know I love you? And feed my sheep. Peter, that's not who you are. You're a new creation. See, God doesn't make you different. He makes you new. God didn't bring you here tonight to make you different. He desires to make you new. God didn't come into your life and flood your life and flood your relationships and flood every aspect of who you are to make you different. He's making you his. He's making you new. He has plans for you. Plans to prosper you. He's created you. You're his masterpiece to walk through the good works which he's created for you to walk in, Ephesians 2:10. A plan and a purpose for you to do something incredible through you. And anyone here who is currently headed toward heaven has been born again. And this second birth gives you the hope of eternal life. I was here for the services on Sunday, and I was rather discouraged. I've been sick for about 3.5 weeks, and I was just fighting discouragement. And I was up here after the service meeting with people, and this sweet little 9-year-old girl walks up with her dad. And her dad starts and says, she would like you to pray for her mom. She came out of kids ministry today and said, I want the pastor to pray for me. Her mom has breast cancer, just had a double mastectomy, and is about to go into the final stages of chemo. Would you just pray for her healing, pray that she would live? I told her it would be my greatest honor and privilege of the week to pray for this sweet little girl. She was so sweet, smile and just kind as can be. And I got to tell her, you know, my mother had cancer as well. Same kind of cancer, same kind of surgery, same kind of chemo. She's still with me. And I got to share with her that hope. But that's a fleeting hope. I said, let me ask you a question. Is your mom a believer? She said, yes, my mommy loves Jesus. Oh. Your mom, he's going to live forever. I cannot see what happens in the midst of the cancer and the chemo, but your mom is going to live forever. She has an eternal hope that changes everything. This life is just a tiny glimpse. It's a commercial, and then there's forever. And you cannot live this life for this life because it makes it look like you don't believe in the forever. If you just live this life for this life, it's like you don't really think there's a forever. And she's going to live forever. Your mommy has been chosen to walk in obedience as she suffers. She's been chosen to be born again, to endure this suffering different than someone who is in this world and suffers without hope. And your mommy has been chosen to receive an inheritance. Let's talk about that. Third point, chosen to receive an inheritance. Chosen to receive an inheritance. And into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. Peter writes, this is an alliteration in the Greek. and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance, it's not like they bought stock in WorldCom or something. Like it's secure. It's not going to depreciate. It's going to last forever. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. Who through faith, this is you talking about, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Friends, what problem on earth is not solved by an eternal inheritance? Inheritance is a word that Peter's audience would have known well, because in this day, you would choose your heir. So like Nero, for example, was chosen by his uncle, not his dad, his uncle to be the heir to the throne, to receive that inheritance. You know, you would choose somebody, not necessarily even a family member. Like you'd go out and find someone who you thought would take care of your riches and you would choose them. God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, who owns a cattle on 1,000 hills, and every piece of gold he created and everything he owns, and he says, who am I going to entrust it to? And he chooses you. And it feels not intimate, because you're like, well, he chooses me and all the other Christians. He there's enough to go around. Eternal riches. You will not go for naught. You will not feel like you didn't receive your part or enough. I'm certain. He makes you an heir. So imagine you came in tonight and you're like, oh, my job, my car, got the check engine lights always on, my apartment, it's too small and too expensive, not to mention my roommates. That's not nice. My bank account. All my problems would be solved if I was rich and I didn't have to worry about these things. And if I get sick while I'm at it, how about I take health too? I'd be healthy all the time. And let's just say you came in here and I was able to give you that. Let's just say everyone here received millions of dollars. We made national news. Everyone at the porch left a millionaire. Don't move. It's not going to happen, right? But let's just say, don't rush the stage, everyone leaves a millionaire. It's a life-changing event. For the rest of your life, you'd remember this day. You'd tell everyone about this day. You know, they'd come and visit you at your estate and be greeted by your butler and come in, and you'd be like, yeah, the porch, man, they're just handing out money. You know, it was great, making it rain. How is this not better than that? We just don't believe it. This is so much more life-changing than that event that might last you another 50 years. This is so much more life-changing. This is an eternal riches. It's so much more than a measly $1 million. We just don't believe this text. We look at it and we say, God, you're lying. We do not believe it. We don't allow it to penetrate our hearts. It will not change our tomorrow unless the Spirit by His grace. Who through faith, verse 5, you through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Underline shielded by God's power, because that's pretty awesome. What does it mean? You're an heir. When I was in the corporate world, I had this customer in Mexico, based out of Mexico, owned a $1 billion company in Mexico. And when he would take his children to work, he would take them to work by way of helicopter with Navy SEALs as their guards, because they were a kidnapping risk. Because someone wanted to take them and hold them as ransom. And so because they were valuable and because their inheritance was valuable, they were well protected. You're valuable, your inheritance is eternal, and you're shielded by God's power. I was thinking about this this week, and so I looked up the most heavily guarded places, places like prisons with high walls and fences and lots of guards. There's this weird seed vault in Antarctica. Look it up later, but it's pretty crazy. And places like Fort Knox, in Fort Knox, Kentucky, where the U.S. stores most of their gold, over 5,000 tons. This gold sits behind a 22-ton vault door. The vault uses a combination that has to be entered by at least 10 different staff members who each have their own code. It's concrete-lined granite walls, alarms surrounding the entire facility. There's army tanks outside the building, fences and guards, and an Apache helicopter that flies over. It is a well-guarded facility. And as I looked up the most well-guarded facilities in the world, I saw places like Fort Knox. But they missed the most well-guarded facility in the world. They missed it. Google missed it. Let me show it to you. That's it. That's it. And wherever you're at right now, wherever you're listening, I showed a picture of the church. It's God's people shielded by God's power, that nothing is going to happen to you 1 second before God's providential ordained will. You will not die. You are eternal. You are immortal until God is done with you. You can leave those doors and you can face any persecution with a smile, any challenge with hope, any moment of discouragement reflecting on your eternal inheritance that will not fade or perish or spoil. And so, in summary, you've been chosen to be made obedient, chosen to be born again into a living hope, and chosen to receive an inheritance. I also read this story this week about a man named Thomas Martinez in Bolivia. Thomas was a beggar on the streets, 67 years old, true story. And he would stand on the corner and beg for change. He'd take the change into the local bar. He had an alcohol problem. He would spend the money that he collected on drugs and alcohol. And when he didn't collect enough money, he had been known to write fake checks, hot checks. And he'd write these checks to fund his drug and alcohol problem. And this was well known. This kind of spread throughout the community. And Thomas is there in a bar, his favorite bar in Bolivia, when the police come in and they're asking around. He catches word that they're looking for him, and so he leaves out the back door, never to be seen again. The police were looking for him because he had received a $6 million inheritance. 40 years earlier, he was married to a woman and he left her, but they never divorced. After they were married, she received a large inheritance, and then she passed away, and this inheritance was left to Thomas. He's on the street, but he has no idea that he's a millionaire. And so as someone comes to give him this gift, he flees. Afraid of what they might ask of him, afraid of the changes that they might enforce upon him, not understanding that he's been chosen to receive an inheritance, he runs. And I think of so many of you here tonight, terrified that God's going to ask you to break up with them or not date them or move or change jobs or dress different or hang out with different people in different places. And it's time, because you're here. You can wrestle, what am I chosen? Consider where you're at on a Tuesday night. What you're listening to, that God in his mercy would give you this message. And do not sneak out the back door, because what he is asking of you is only to give you life. God does not ask anything of you that is not for your supreme best, Nothing. There is nothing, no matter how hard, no matter how tall of an order, that God would ask of you that is not for your absolute best. He's not trying to rip you off. He desires to set you free. He desires to invite you in to his incredible riches. You've been chosen. He chooses you. He's chosen you out of your habits. Some of you out of your relationship. And some of you out of your struggles. Some of you he's chosen out of your idols. Some of you he's chosen out of your families. He's chosen you out of your past. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, who's died for your sins, by the same Spirit that raised him from the dead, that Spirit now seeks to help you through this life, shielding you by God's power to the finish line, to the eternal riches. And that's the truth. Let me pray we'd believe it. Father, thank you for your servant Peter. For the truth that you have for us just through the greetings of this great text. Father, would you awaken our hearts all over this country and all over this world? Would you awaken the hearts of young adults of 20s and 30 somethings everywhere, that they would trade in the American dreams, that they would trade in their hope and the things that they're holding on to and their trinkets and their treasures, and they would make this incredible great exchange for this eternal inheritance, that they would see you as enough, God. And that they would live every waking moment of their life for you. And when they lay down to sleep, you say you give to your children, even as they sleep, that you would give to them, Lord. That your Spirit would conform their lives to something better than anything this world could offer them. That they would live for Jesus, King Jesus. That Jesus would be their Lord. That Jesus would be their master. Jesus, become our master. No longer slaves to this world, but that we would be slaves to righteousness. In Jesus' name, amen. No longer slaves to this world, but that we would be slaves to righteousness. In Jesus' name, amen.